The Chimeran threat began in Russia. The origin of the virus is unknown, but its effects were devastating and swift. In the 1930s, reports of biological experiments began leaking out of Russia. Then reports of villages destroyed overnight. Then entire cities. We feared the Russians had developed a weapon of unparalleled power. The truth was far worse. The Chimera stayed sealed within Russia for over a decade. Then, in 1949, they launched an attack that overwhelmed all of Europe in a matter of weeks. For several months, we thought England was safe. But in October of 1950, the Chimera burrowed under the Channel. We had prepared for them, but in 3 months' time, the war was lost. We abandoned the cities to the Chimera and retreated to scattered military bases and outposts. The Chimera had won. On July the 11th, 1951, the Americans launched an assault on the eastern coast of England. On the second wave of that assault was a sergeant named Nathan Hale. The actions of that soldier have become a matter of both scrutiny and myth. What follows are the known events of his life from July 11th to July the 14th, the day he was last seen. Soldiers had no idea what they would soon be facing. The US government had sealed its borders in 1950. Radio waves and newspapers became state property. Only the highest levels of their government knew the truth. The operation was an exchange. The Americans were bringing supplies and tanks into York. We were giving them our one secret weapon, something we could offer that they couldn't build themselves. I was the commander of the convoy team that was to meet the US soldiers. We were ambushed in Manchester on the way to the rendezvous. There was no way to warn the Americans. They were on their own in York, fighting an enemy they knew nothing about. We never learnt exactly what happened there. All we know is that Nathan Hale was the sole survivor.
Got it bad. Come on, let's get to the depot, double time.
Captain, you seeing this?
What the hell is that?
No one knows exactly how Hale was infected by the Chimeran virus. Our only clue is a journal entry recovered from the body of a US medic. It says that he encountered a number of comatose soldiers in a dry creek bed. One of the soldiers, a sergeant, suddenly woke up. Unlike the other soldiers, his body had no wounds at all. The sergeant refused any kind of medical examination, insisting on catching up to the rest of the company. If that sergeant was in fact Nathan Hale, then he remains the only known person to wake up after being infected. Whether the Chimeran virus mutated within him, or whether his body had an innate resistance to it, remains a mystery.
You all right? They told me Arrow 2 was wiped out. Come on.
This is Winters. Baker 1 approaching Kilo Road, 2 clicks from the depot. Who's near my position? Sound off. Baker 1, this is 3. We're moving wounded. It's slow going. Baker 12.
Regrouped at an abandoned bus depot in southeast York. Under the command of a Captain Winters, they staged a daring tactical offensive. The Chimera had begun to close in on their position. If the Americans could secure the site, they would have a perfect landing zone, and the battle would tip in their favor.
They're really dug in there, sir!
They must know this is the prime landing zone. If we can hold it, we'll get some reinforcements of our own in here.
Yes, sir.
Defensive positions. Swain, run a sweep on the north and east walls. Blair, give me south and west. I want to know what's heading this way before we're gagging on it.
Just hold this little piece of heaven. Tapazzini, bring those tanks in here and scrape out a landing zone.
Sir!
Incoming!
We know from the craters that the Chimera ended the battle by launching spires. There is no defense against a spire attack. By the time you see them in the air, it's already too late. After impact, the spires release swarms of crawlers. Literally thousands of them can come from a single spire. Whole cities have been infected in minutes. After the crawlers have done their work, the Chimeras send in carriers to collect the dormant victims. The role of the carriers is to transport infected humans to conversion centers. It's at these locations that the Chimeran creatures are born. Hale was brought to a conversion center in the town of Grimsby. My convoy team and I were imprisoned at the same location. We had been captured uninfected, so we were put in makeshift pens until they could infect us.
Sergeant Hale, First Rangers.
An American? We thought the Chimera stopped all of you in York.
Chimera?
Those creatures. Oh, you jammed it. Sorry, Hale. Looks like you'll have to find your own way out. I'll be in touch. Frequency 77.6. It was strange enough that a lone American soldier was walking around a Khmeran conversion center, but it was his eyes that were most disturbing. They showed unmistakable Khmeran traits. It was subtle, but it was there. Whoever Nathan Hale was, he wasn't entirely human. The conversion center was built on top of an old fish cannery. Networks of tubes transported the bodies from one stage of conversion to another. Once humans are infected by the Khmeran virus, they fall into a coma. The virus begins changing their bodies from the inside out, eventually turning them into one of the Khmeran creatures. The conversion centers simply speed up the process.
Sergeant Hale, come in. I'm seeing more hybrid patrols now. They must know we've escaped. Be careful.
During the second phase of the conversion process, the humans are wrapped in cocoons. This accelerates the final stages of the conversion. What emerges from the cocoon is determined by the strain of the virus. Each Khmeran creature is created by a separate strain. What we call hybrids, the ones that most closely resemble humans, have the shortest gestation period. The more beastly creatures take months to create and are made from multiple human bodies. The stage of the Khmeran conversion process is known as the birthing chamber. The cocoons are opened and new Khmera are born. In the case of hybrids, a cooling apparatus is fused into their bodies. The Khmeran metabolism is roughly 12 times that of humans. This results in remarkable healing abilities, but also raises their body temperatures significantly. Without the cooling apparatus, the hybrids would overheat and die. I was able to make it to the surface and summon a rescue. Flying into the Khmeran territory was always dangerous, but we had to risk it. Hale made it out shortly after. I looked for any further signs of conversion. Fever, nervous movement, paranoia. There was nothing. Just the gold-colored eyes. We flew directly to Manchester. Soldiers had been trying to recover the convoy ever since my squad was ambushed. They knew what was in it. They knew it was our last hope for defeating the Khmera. I wanted to take Hale back to Northern Command for debriefing. Maybe he could sense I was suspicious of him. He joined the Manchester squad before I could say a word. Stranded on the west side of Manchester. The site was guarded by stalkers, so the only route in was on foot. A radio message from Hale's squad said they were entering Manchester Cathedral. The cathedral was a field hospital during the war. It was abandoned in a hurry and still had some supplies and ammunition. Unfortunately, it was also a breeding ground for some of the lower forms of Khmera.
Thank you. central to command. Site secure. All stalkers down. You've got your convoy. How about getting us a sodding medic?
Approached the containment cell on the convoy. The cell had 14-inch lead walls, but even so, given Hale's condition, I didn't want him anywhere near it. With the stalkers gone, we were able to airlift the cell back to Northern Command. The exchange with the Americans would have to wait. We were about to execute a very risky offensive operation. The Chimera had been using a network of underground tunnels to attack undetected. The tunnels formed a nexus in Nottingham, and if we sealed them off, we would at least briefly have the upper hand. Directing the battle from the air when I saw Cartwright's squad had run into heavy resistance. I needed to get them help right away. A group of soldiers had just stormed a Chimera mortar position. Hale was the only one to make it out. I radioed him to look for a shortcut through an old train tunnel. The tunnel was mostly blocked by a Chimeran power conduit, but I knew if Hale could find a way through, it would turn the tide of the battle.
Come looking for a fight? You found the place.
It seems the Chimera are up to something more than just digging tunnels. Say, look here. Who brought the Yank?
By that time, word had already spread about what Hale did in Manchester. However, Cartwright wasn't the type to be easily impressed, especially by an American. Cartwright's team had found something suspicious. Instead of just making tunnels, the Chimera were digging something out of the ground. At the time, we passed it off as just another Chimeran mystery. Our priority was to seal off the tunnels.
Lieutenant Cartwright, Operation Shear has tied up the bulk of the Chimeran defense in Nottingham.
Affirmative, Command! Keep them off us, and we'll wrap this up in a jiffy.
Yeah.
Nottingham operation was a success. I sent the troops back to Southern Command for a well-earned rest. I was taking Hale to the Intelligence Division at Northern Command for debriefing. I radioed Northern Command on our approach. No response. As we landed, I could already sense the worst. The whole place was deathly silent. Trying to radio Hale since the cave-in. I knew how the Chimera had found Northern Command, and more importantly, I knew why. They were after what the convoy had been carrying in Manchester. It had been carefully sealed in a specimen tank in our research lab. We thought it would be unable to call the Chimera from within the tank. We were badly mistaken. There was no way to warn Hale of the danger he was in. If he opened that tank, the result could be disastrous. What was inside would either kill him or control him. I knew Hale would eventually find the map room. Everything we had learned about the Chimera in the past 2 decades was in there. We had maps of the Chimera invasion spreading through Russia, autopsy records of Chimeran creatures, charts of the death tolls across Europe. These were numbers we didn't even disclose to our own soldiers. There were files that showed the progression of the Chimeran virus in humans. In over 6,000 cases, there were no records of any form of human resistance. There were also detailed schematics of our specimen tank and what was in it. We call them angels. They're the most powerful of all the Chimera. We believe the angels control other forms of Chimera via some form of telepathy. For all I knew, this one was already controlling Hale. Given up hope of him surviving when I saw Hale coming up in the lift. I could tell from his face that he had found the angel. There was no point in asking. If he was alive, then the angel was dead. Hale was starting to show more effects of the conversion process. His movements had the unnatural quickness of the hybrids. Judging from the bullet holes in his uniform, he had acquired their healing capabilities as well. We had tracked the Chimera leaving Northern Command to a gorge in Somerset. Cartwright led a squad of soldiers after them. It had been 2 hours since he had reported in. Hale volunteered to go after them. I expected he would locate Cartwright. There was no way I could have imagined what else he would discover in that gorge.
Team.
Come on, we gotta move.
Give it a moment.
Cartwright was the best soldier in my command. Nothing got past him. He must have known Hale was infected when they first met in Nottingham. Fortunately, Cartwright never cared too much about the small stuff.
The chimera that gutted Northern Command came from this gorge. We're going to find just what hole they crawled out of, so we might marshal a little retribution. We've covered out here. Let's get past that fence.
The Chimera tend to establish themselves near large population centers. Their presence in a remote region like Somerset was highly unusual. The gorge was filled with factories that built stalkers and dropships, but we had seen those before. Deeper into the gorge, the Chimera were hiding something far more alarming.
We'll find the Chimeran base faster if we split up. Take the other path. Give a shout if you find anything out of the ordinary. Or should I say, when you find anything?
Had discovered the key to the entire Chimeran strategy. The tower they found had not been constructed, it had been excavated. That single fact changed everything we knew about the Chimera. Leaving Somerset, they must have noticed the power conduits radiating from the tower behind them. We believe this discovery is what inspired Hale's fateful actions later that day. The drive to Southern Command would have taken at least an hour. Time enough for the Chimera to launch a strike force.
I'll handle the stalkers, you get to the base. We have to make sure everyone gets out.
Fought off the worst of the attack on the northern entrance. But we then faced a graver threat. The Chimera had infiltrated the hangar on the south side. If we didn't get the planes out safely, then all would truly be lost.
Get to the hangar! Make sure all the transports get out!
Sergeant Hale, rendezvous with Lieutenant Everly in the hangar straight away.
soldiers were finally able to fight off the Chimera in the hangar. We ferried the survivors up to a rendezvous point in Cardiff, 20 miles west. I stayed at the base to finish loading what supplies we could. Chimeran Goliaths were already approaching Southern Command. A Spire attack seemed inevitable.
Get in here. We've got scores to settle.
Lost. More than half our troops were lost with it. If not for the heroism of Cartwright and Hale, many more would have been killed, myself included. We were flying the survivors to a makeshift camp in Cardiff. Despite my insistence, Hale refused to board the last plane. The last time I saw Hale, he was looking over a map Cartwright had given him. I learned later that it detailed the known paths of the power conduits. The conduits only run above ground for a short distance before burrowing deep into the Chimeran tunnels. Entering those tunnels is nothing short of suicide. Nevertheless, I believe that is exactly what Hale did. We had been at Cardiff for several hours when I received a radio message from Hale. He told me he was in London, and he asked if snow was normal for July. He described a tower in the middle of London, one far bigger than that which they had found in Somerset, and with power conduits emerging in all directions. He said, "If we destroy the tower, we destroy the Chimera." For all I knew, Hale was completely mad. And even if what he was saying was true, we had no idea how to destroy the tower. But there was one new factor working in our favor. I had been able to contact the Americans, and they had joined forces with us in Cardiff. I decided to gamble that Hale was right. I convinced the Americans to help launch a full assault on the tower. We were bringing everything we had to London. I was counting on Hale to clear out a landing zone. If he couldn't take out the Stalkers, the mission would be over before it began. forces arrived in London nearly unscathed. It was hard not to stare in awe at the tower. We had only fled London 6 months earlier, and now it was almost unrecognizable. The whole city was covered in snow. I knew the Chimera thrived in cold weather, but it was hard to fathom how they might actually be altering the climate itself. The power conduits, the snow, and the tower had to be related in some way. There was no time to think about it. Their armies were already guarding the tower, and more would be coming. We set the tanks up in assault formation and started across Tower Bridge. The last tanks were crossing the bridge when we saw Goliaths approaching from behind. We had to destroy the bridge before they caught up to our tanks. Hale and a few other soldiers took up defensive positions while the charges were being set. Growing bleaker by the second. Our tanks had killed legions of Chimera, but still they poured out of the tower. The Chimeran forces were holding us in check while their Goliaths closed in on Southwark Bridge. With Tower Bridge destroyed, there was no possibility of retreat. The team I sent to destroy Southwark Bridge was not responding. It would only be a matter of time before we heard the spires in the air.
I know. I was only trying to disable it. Let's go. We have to catch that Goliath.
Hale here, who nearly got himself killed. I would hope not. We've reached the center of command operation. I'm counting on him
bad shooting, I'd say. Considering I was hit and all. You go ahead. I'll cover this entrance.
The battle outside the tower. The few tanks that remained would soon be overwhelmed by the seemingly infinite hordes of Chimera. Our only hope lay with the few soldiers who had managed to infiltrate the tower. It was up to them to find a way to destroy it from the inside.
Keep following the power conduits.
As the tower fell, Chimeran creatures began to shriek and writhe on the ground. They died within minutes. We believe they were simply unable to survive the loss of the angels. The significance of our victory in London wasn't understood for several days. The reactor meltdown caused a chain reaction that destroyed all the towers in the network. At least in Britain, the Chimera were defeated. We have investigated the ruins of five towers so far. As we attempt to reverse engineer the complex technologies we find, the mystery of the Chimera only deepens. With combat subsided, the soldiers have been searching the rural villages for survivors. So far, we found 921 hiding in bunkers and basements, 78 of them children. Cartwright's youngest daughter, Angela, was among them. As for Nathan Hale, his body was never recovered. He was presumably incinerated inside the tower. The American military lists him as killed in action, July the 14th, 1951. A part of me still believes he might have escaped somehow. I even thought I heard his voice on the radio just after the tower exploded. I'll never know for sure.